All right, we were gonna try this class last time, and we didn't make it through. Pharisee, elder son, disciple, or harlot, who do you want to be? What we're gonna do is we're gonna look a little bit into the scripture, particularly the prodigal son, but also bring in another set. And we're going to find that there are people who are in tune with the Lord's heart, and there are people who are not. And, you know, I remember someone saying once, there are two kinds of people in the world, people who love Neil Diamond and people who don't. That's random, sorry. But there are people who are in tune with his heart, and there are probably much, much, much more people who aren't in tune with his heart, but certainly in tune with the ministry they're called to, or in tune with the earthly church, or in tune with some aspect that certainly relates to the Lord and his desire, and I think this is the key, his desire is that we be in tune with him. Now you can understand that. He's the husband, he's the head of the church, he's the Lord, he's, you know what I mean? It's like, he would want that. I'm just guessing. That's something that he would want and desire, really on a personal basis with each and every one of us. When it comes to, you know, we're discussing the prodigal son story. When it comes to really knowing what the father wants, you kind of have to know the son. And not just watch the son and see what he likes and then try to do that to the father and dupe the father into thinking that, you know, we're what he wants. but the true and clear path there is to be conformed to the image of his son. Again, not to the Christ or the Savior or the Jesus of Nazareth who walked the earth, but the Son, because we're talking about the Father. And it's going to take that Son because that's the way the Lord ordained it. And if you have any questions about that, read Colossians chapter 1 all the way through to, verse 18. It's just overpowering how much emphasis the Father has put upon his Son. So there's those who are not in tune, and so the things that Jesus might deem as valuable, they might call waste. Now, you're familiar with that word, right? Okay. They might call waste. The prodigal son story, as certainly barely mentioned, but the prodigal son story really was told by Jesus in relationship to the Pharisees and the attitudes that they were exhibiting, and they were exhibiting certain attitudes and thoughts and viewpoints, and then Jesus goes into these parables, particularly in relationship to the prodigal son, but certainly all of them. So Luke chapter 15, verse 1 and 2. And this is what brought about Jesus telling the story of the prodigal son. These two verses. Then drew near unto him all the republicans and sinners. Oh, I'm sorry. Tax collectors and sinners, for to hear him. If that were the case, I'm one of them publicans, okay? And the Pharisees and scribes murmured, saying, "This man receiveth sinners and eateth with them." And he spake this parable unto them, saying, okay, so then he goes into the three-layered presentation, ending with the prodigal son, ending with something that's like literally not of this earth in the sense, because the Father and the Son were before the world was. So you could say that the family was before the earth, a father and a son. Okay. And the spirit of that was meant, is eternal, apparently. You know. And as such, therefore, is something dear to the Father and something dear to the Son, and is something that always has been in their relationship. And that, as spoken several times in the past, truly our fellowship needs to be between the Father and the Son instead of some Christian fellowship. You understand what I mean when I say that. I'm not saying we shouldn't have Christian fellowship or whatever, but I am saying that the primary fellowship, the eternal fellowship, is between the Father and the Son, and we've been brought into that by being made one with the Son. And by being made one with the Son means more. You know, we can word it, we could say by being joined to the Son, but his heart would require more than joining, and it would result in oneness, which is a flow of that reality, a living reality of it, not a mental religious grasp of certain concepts that we may be able to teach really well. But my God, if that's it, I mean, what a sad, sad thing to spend our whole life teaching the right stuff and never really getting hold of it by life, and let's just say it, by Christ himself, the Son. Therefore, the Father never, regardless, never gets what he wanted in the whole thing. So they're murmuring about this situation, and as I said, you know, it's about waste, because the word prodigal means waste. Waste. And we'll get into it a little more, but let me just say that the elder son looked at what the father was doing and honoring in the prodigal as a waste. This is just a waste. The Pharisees were going, why is Jesus honoring these? This is just a waste. And the Son is what they're out of tune with. They're out of tune with the heart of the Son. Okay, so we want to go through that, because when the elder son finally comes on the scene and starts to attack the prodigal son to the father, at that stage, the prodigal son has made the transition from hog pen through altar sacrifice to feasting with the father. So it's the son that he's attacking.
That's right.
See? But unknowingly. So that makes it okay, right? Unknowingly. I fear that there's a lot that goes on unknowingly in the name of, you know, sincerity or whatever, that we just violate some very important realities. And, you know, I never say stuff like that to bring people into condemnation. I don't. In fact, condemnation is so far from my mind, it doesn't come up that I should do that or would be doing that. For me, I look into either Jesus' heart or the heart of the Father, and I see what they desire, and then I look at me or you or And I, when I see a disparagement, I would like us, you know, me, because it's always, it always starts here. It does. It always starts here. To, you know, to make that leap from where we are to where his heart wants us at that moment. And I will say this also. I do not, this is personal, I do not believe that teaching this will make the difference, will get us there or get me there. Or, you know, I don't. You say, then why are you standing up there talking? You know, well, hopefully I'm planting seeds, but, you know, one plants, one waters, but God gives the increase. There is no guarantees on anything. And a lot of that depends on the individual's heart also, but it is, you know, because some seed fell into hard ground, or some seed fell by the wayside, or some seed, you know, all the same seed. But God has to give that increase. And I was back in my office, and what was it? I know this is going to sound so dumb, okay? I'm in my office, and I'm peeling away some paper for something, and I've got a wastebasket there, and he shoots, and it's good. And I I thought how often I do that at home and everything else, and I'm really good at just shooting and making it, okay? And then that thought ran through my mind. And then the thought ran through my mind, well, if, you know, not that we don't boast in these things that we were good at. You know what I mean? This is not what we're supposed to. That shouldn't even be brought into the thing. And yet, that's what makes Facebook. Or our lives. And we center on that, and we want to promote that, and we want people to see that and acknowledge it, and maybe, you know, acknowledge it as a small word, you know, to really go, wow. And then it just flashed, thank God for the Holy Spirit, because thank God I want to be in a realm of something. I don't want to just be shooting baskets. The Holy Spirit says, if I will boast, I will boast in my infirmities. Okay, well, that's so contrary to every Christian's thinking just about. That's what I'm good at. I will boast in that. I will boast in the fact that he brings me down. He shows me my lack. He brings me to a place of reliance on him, that I have no desire to boast in what I'm good at. You see the line of thought. And I don't know personally that I'm there yet, but I know that I'm pressing toward the mark of the prize of the high calling in him, whereby if any man glories, let him glory in the Lord. What is the Lord? Not what I deem the Lord or what I deem good about me. All right. So all of that, people can have a hard time with that. It's just very simply saying that we may get soft enough in our heart that we really actually care more for what he wants than what we want. And we set about, an adjustment starts happening. And I mean, I think that's what took place with the prodigal. Because there was the coming down first, you know, and then the altar. The coming down, the brokenness didn't do it. Right. I'm not worthy, but don't you agree that there has to be a softening of our ground, or the suits just bounce off of us? My God. You know, and that was part of the whole soaking thing that we were about, so that what was coming could fill us. And So the elder son attacks the son. The son, unknowingly, has no clue that that's what he's doing. But because of his issues, and because of, and issues are earthly, and earthly issues are my life, or what I'm not getting, or, you know, all of that. Just so wrapped up in this world, even though it's maybe a Christian world, you know what I mean? It's our little Christian world. It's still where we're living. It's still what's important to us. And he did it. He did it probably for a couple of reasons. He did it because he viewed the prodigal son from the past. Okay, but you know, that's, even though that's a big deal, we hardly ever get over that one. We that's a hard one to negotiate for us, because it's like these little pressure points within us or something like that, and the past is also a reminder of wounds and stuff, and so that's what we're thinking about. We can't see the sun. But the other reason, and the bigger reason, is because we're not seeing the sun. I mean, that's the bigger reason. The bigger reason is wherever we are, and you know, I mean, I was, I don't know, Nisi just got back from Guatemala, and just got back, and so Deb called me, and because she was over there, and I drove in my truck, and as I was driving, I was just, I don't know why, but there was, just looking around at all the flurry and all the traffic and all that was going on, I thought, this life is so formed that it sucks the life and the time and the energy and everything out of leaving even the slightest time for the Lord. I mean, it's almost like there was like a prince over this world that was making it hard to get to Jesus. Yeah, I don't know. And it was a very sad thing to me, because I realized, you know, try as anyone sincerely wants to, you got an uphill battle going on just trying to get time with the Lord. And that's not even talking about quality time. That's just, you know, making sure you get a sip and so you don't die or something, you know what I mean? And it's for that reason that there has to be times we've done everything from solemn assemblies to whatever else, but, you know, from time to time, just real, you know. I mean, I know that we do the Seek the Lord time sometimes on Sunday night and stuff, but as you know, that's good. Thank God for it. But that doesn't tip the scales. It usually won't. Anyway, so there is this blindness because of our world, our life, and there is this blindness because that world and that life is pulling and tearing and you know, not allowing us that we're not seeing the heart of the sun. Okay, and I want to make a difference there between the heart of the sun and seeing Jesus in the scriptures. Is that okay? Because there is a difference there. The heart of the Son is the eternal reality that works in him towards the Father, and you get glimpses of the Father's love back. Remember how the Father was treating the prodigal? He was doing it toward the Son, not just the prodigal, the Son. And that need. That need to be able to not just see something fresh in the scriptures and feel okay, But to, for me, it's a little bit like, and I know this is dumb, it's a little bit like walking in our earth, trying to press in, and all of a sudden you press against something and you're in Narnia. You know what I mean? You know, it's a whole realm. It's something that will get you. It'll get you. You don't have to get it. It'll get you. But there's that preparation. There's all that stuff that has to roll and come to a certain place because it's all progressive. It, just like creation, you know, this and this and this and this and this. It doesn't just happen. It doesn't just happen. And once we recognize that it doesn't just happen, then we say, Lord, I want to know the progression, but only for one reason. I want to know your heart, Father, or I want to know your heart, Jesus. You see what I'm saying? The emphasis for it is no longer the knowledge to stand up and, you know, I mean, sometimes when people share here or anywhere, their goal is to preach, you know, I'm going to teach you. And, you know, our heart can't be that. It can't be. We can't just, you know, we've been teachers. Let's stop being teachers. Let's be those who are after the Son and after the heart of the Son so that we may know the Father by the Son. All right. I've already got the smiley face, so it's over with. Didn't seem like 20 minutes, did it?